虽然人权是普世的，但是他们得成为法律，才能使国家受到约束，尊重他们。另外，有些群体有特殊的要求或特点，这些因素也必须考虑，才能使他们享有人权。比如世界人权宣言第23条规定了工作权，但是对于残疾人士，具体指的是什么呢？再比如说，公民和政治权利公约规定了在政治和经济生活中免受歧视的权利，那这个规定怎样能够保护一名只是因为是女性而没有得到工作机会的大学毕业生呢？所以需要一个辅助框架，这就是国际人权条约。为了监督条约的落实，联合国设立了条约机构，由独立的非政治性的专家审议公约的缔约国，并且建议缔约国如何履行其义务。
Many NGOs know about this very important treaty body system because, as you may know, there are about 10 international human rights instruments at the United Nations on human rights, on many issues, civil and political rights, economic, social, cultural rights, racial discrimination, discrimination of women, right of the child, of disabled persons, against enforced disappearances of persons, many, many issues. And especially the NGOs, an emanation from the civil society, work in a very important way with the treaty bodies. Those international human rights instruments have each of them a committee who is looking about the implementation of the treaty by the state parties. And the state parties have to produce periodically a written report about how they implement the treaty.
一般来说，国际法，尤其是人权法，都面临一个挑战，就是公约的签署并不是自动使公约的条款成为国内法。首先，政府要签署条约，然后国家必须要批准它。只有当这两个步骤都完成了，公约的条款才能成为国家的人权义务。国内法呢，必须与这些义务相符。
我觉得最大的帮助就是这个它的人权的公约会给你一个框架。可能你在国内你会觉得啊，这个问题很重要，那个问题很重要。因为国内的法它可能有很多法，但它也是比较零散的。如果你通过国际公约的话，你会有一个框架，比如说妇女的权益、儿童的权益，还有残障人的权利，你都可以从公约找到哪些权利是很重要的，然后他应该是怎么去理解这些权利的。
有的时候，某个国家可能会不同意条约的某个部分做出保留，比如中国不承认禁止酷刑委员会接收个人投诉，虽然这项权利是包含在公约中的。那么公民社会如何可以参与条约机构呢？
The issue is that, the state says, well, everything is perfect, but NGOs have sometimes, and often, I must say, a different opinion about that. So some of them, they put themselves together in a coalition of NGOs and they produce a shadow report.As a counter exercise to the official report by the state. And even more than that, sometimes they do, all the time they are asked by the committee to come to see them, and the committee asks them questions about the situation in the country who has produced this report.What I didn't say is that the country not only produces a report, but has to send a delegation to the committee. And the committee asks questions. And if the committee asks the NGOs about their own appreciation of the legal and factual situation of human rights in the said country, this gives them an opportunity to ask good questions to the state the next day during the session. And at the end of the process, the committee takes conclusions and recommendations to the states. And the states has usually 1 year to report back to say how he did or if he didn't implement these recommendations. So that's the way the system functions. So the role of the NGO is very important to inform the treaty body of the legal and factual situation in the country under scrutiny.
In the context of a treaty body review, civil society inputs directly to the government when possible, but definitely directly to the committee, are really important tools for shaping the debate before and during the dialogue. After the review happens, defenders can in turn use the output of that review, the concluding observations, to push their governments to make change on the ground. It's really a function of this follow-up engagement and implementation that makes change happen.
因为这个联合国的这种倡导保障人权的这种机制，那么在一定程度上会从外界去督促和改善中国的这种人权的状况，可以通过自联合国这种人权这种机制啊，通过这种机制呢，那么对中国大陆目前所存在这种特殊的这种人权的这种严重问题呢，给予关注，给予督促，给予压力。那么在这种情况下呢，使中国大陆的公权不能够完全的一意孤行，他要考虑到国际上的影响。那么这样的话呢，我认为他会对中国的人权的促进有帮助。
现在我们来回顾一下，条约机构是由独立专家组成的委员会，每个委员会监督一部具体的人权法，各国必须对履行义务的情况作出汇报，非政府组织可以在整个过程中的所有阶段以各种方式参与条约机构。